ladies and gentlemen. I'm Bruce Dumont, the president of the Museum of Broadcast Communications. Thank you very much for joining us on a beautiful, beautiful Saturday afternoon. It's nice to have so many with you, so many of you with us in person. And for those that are listening to the live stream around the world, it's nice to have you with us as well. If you want to tweet some of your friends that the live stream is going on or send a quick email message to them, you can do that right now. And as soon as you do that, I ask you to turn your phones off so we don't get a lot of incoming calls. How many people here today are members of the Museum of Broadcast Communications? Okay, a small smattering of hands have gone up. For those of you who are not members, first of all, if you are a member, you come to all of these events free, there's no charge. And secondly, you can come to the museum as often as you want throughout the year. So a $30 investment, which is what a basic membership is, if you will consider joining the museum, you get advanced notification of what we're doing. We've got a lot of great programs coming up for the rest of the year. So again, that's one way that the museum can continue to grow is through the support of expanding our membership base. So again, for those of you who did not put your hand up, if you want to see Shannon Barnes, the young lady at the front desk, as you leave, she is the membership coordinator, and we would appreciate that you give that some consideration. Before we get on to today's program, we welcome you to the National Radio Hall of Fame Gallery. And again, Dick Orkin's picture is hanging right over there, right next to Ira Glass's, if you did not see it when you came in. Let me also remind you that, how many baseball fans do we have in the audience? Any baseball fans? Oh, we have some baseball fans. One of the inductees last year in the class of 2014 with Dick Orkin was John Miller, the voice of the San Francisco Giants. You know him for 20-plus years on ESPN radio. And on Wednesday afternoon, the 6th of August at 12 noon, prior to the Giant-Cub game that evening, John Miller will be our guest. And we will do a similar thing like this with John Miller, and we'll have some of the local sports broadcasters in Chicago here to pay tribute to one of the great sportscasters of all time, certainly one of those who is alive and well and living with us today. I am very pleased to welcome, as our moderator today, one of the oldest and best friends of the museum. Whether it was at WGN, whether it was at WLS, whether it was when he was at Channel 11, or frankly, when we, many, many years ago, when we both went to Columbia College, long, long time ago. But again, he is a broadcaster's broadcaster who, less than a month ago, was inducted into the Silver Circle of the Chicago Television Academy, which really is one of the great things and recognitions for anyone working in local television. He's on Monday through Friday with Marianne Marciano on WGN. Please welcome a great guy from WGN Radio, Bob Surratt.
Thank you, Bruce. Thank you all for coming, and that concludes our program. Well, I don't know where to begin here, so let me just tell you my personal story about our guest today, Dick Orkin. Growing up in Chicago, we were very lucky here to have some pretty good radio, and one of the best radio stations, I think, in the country in the 60s was WCFL. And one of the reasons that radio station was great was they had a great stable of entertainers 24 hours a day. And the production, the sound of the radio station, the special features, the jingles, it was the total package. And the production director behind much of that, Dick Orkin, was responsible for that. And, of course, there was Chicken Man as well. And then later the Tooth Fairy, some added bonus features that we enjoyed listening to for years here in Chicago and across the country, as a matter of fact. And then Dick went on, as you'll hear, to Los Angeles and the Radio Ranch, and you'll hear all about some of the commercials he's done. He's won every award there can be. He's in every Hall of Fame in radio and advertising. I think he's even in Cooperstown in the Baseball Hall of Fame, but that was a clerical error. Why don't we look at the short speech Dick gave when he was inducted into the Radio Hall of Fame, and I believe this was a few years ago out in Los Angeles. So let's take a look at that. Let's listen to Dick's talk, and then we'll bring him up here.
Oh, ladies and gentlemen, the National Radio Hall of Fame is proud to induct my friend, my mentor, Dick Orkin.
Oh, I am truly honored to be here this evening or this afternoon and grateful to be awarded a wonderful place in the Radio Hall of Fame. The moment is especially meaningful to me since my introduction came from someone I deliberately chose because I knew they would not hold back lavish praise of me. I have not been disappointed. I'm referring, of course, to my talented Radio Ranch creative writer and partner, Christine Coyle. She's always extremely effusive and generous with regard to me, and I appreciate that. Her introduction is exactly what I counted on. In fact, to be sure she wasn't, you know, a little off today, I mean, we're all human. I wrote part of that for her. She read it very well. I am pleased to be chosen for the Radio Hall of Fame in the distinguished company of so many talented others who are honored tonight. Although I only know really well one of them, and that, of course, is Ira Glass. And the reason I know so few others now in radio as I, perhaps I should say, the afternoon of my life, or it could be the evening of my life, around 11, 11:30. I find that I am less social and gregarious, generally speaking. My older years have brought me to spending most of my days watching TV and engaging in wild sexual fantasies. I'm only kidding. I don't watch television that much. Finally, I am thrilled that it is the Radio Hall of Fame that recognizes me today. The Radio Hall of Fame, a project of the National Museum of Broadcast Communications. It delivers a statement of the place of radio in our lives. Here are, in its own words, here they are. Radio has given us the freedom to use our imagination, whether it enlightened, engaged, or amused us, radio filtered through our individual sensibilities. When you're next in Chicago, I suggest you walk through the museum, and you'll realize that while the way we listen and what we've heard has changed over the years, radio itself remains a constant and enduring force in our lives. Thank you especially to Bruce DeMont, Tom Couch, and all of you who were responsible for bringing me into this. I thank you again, and this is an impressive occasion. The Radio Hall of Fame, ensuring that radio remains a constant enduring force in our lives. My thanks to all the other inductees and to Miss Christine Coyle especially for superbly setting me up here. And of course, warm thanks to all of you out there, especially my greatest supporter of all, my loving wife, Diane. Thank you, Dee Dee. Thank you all very much.
I think from that you can tell why Dick's radio commercials that he's created are so effective. Let's welcome Dick Orkin.
Thank you.
How long have you been in radio?
Today.
Welcome. Thank
you. Well, hello to all of you. Hello, Bob. Thank you for doing this. And if there's anything that you want to talk about, don't want to talk about, there's some subject that you just as soon not get involved in, political, religious, spiritual, or dietary, anything that would create a problem for you, just don't hesitate. Say, I don't talk about it. That's all you have to do. So what would your first question be?
Well, let's begin with what you're known for around here more than anything else, like it or not, Chicken Man. And as Larry King used to say, why Chicken Man? I don't think he said Chicken Man, but he would say why something. So let's just start with that. Why did you start that and how?
Well, he's right, because I had the damnedest idea why Chicken Man started. Ken Draper, who was the general manager, no, he was the program director of WCFL Radio, noticed one afternoon that on television here, and I think also in Cleveland, that there was a television show, a parody, they call it campy, parody of Chicken, of Batman. Do all of you remember the television Batman series?
Yeah.
It was kind of a goofy, they used the word camp, which I guess meant parody, and it's remained so since then. But that was the basic reason I decided to do Chicken Man, because Draper said, I think people would enjoy hearing or seeing something that...
Excuse me, do you work here, sir? Just checking.
I was just looking for the bathroom.
Why are you giving me this?
Because we can hear you better.
Oh, I see. Okay, all right. Why can they hear you? It doesn't make a damn bit of difference to me. I don't care. What else would you like to know?
So Chicken Man,
Chicken
WCFL.
Man, yes, yeah. And when I tell people the truth about the origins of Chicken Man, I usually say it's because it was a bringing together or a compilation of all of the comic strip heroes. Green Lantern, Superman, Batman, Chicken Man, all of those things. And I was looking for a superhero I could use to create a radio show on WCFL, and that's how Chicken Man came about. I'm not sure that the Tooth Fairy came immediately after that. I don't even remember how soon that. Do you remember?
It came a couple of years after that, I believe.
Okay, thank you. I'm glad you remember these things. And then I don't think that I didn't want to do an animal like a bat to do a cereal. And I wasn't really keen on doing something like Ant-Man, you know, a tiny little thing that crawls around on you as the superhero. That didn't seem to me to have a lot of future to it. So... someone said to me, I think probably one of my kids, "Where are you really being chicken about that, Dad?" And I said, "Oh, Chicken. That's it. Good, Chicken Man." And that was really how Chicken Man started. And I've always liked the notion that the superhero always seems to know more than he does, but fails at it. And my real inspiration for Chicken Man was, let's see how many people remember this guy. Broderick Crawford. Do you remember Broderick Crawford? What was the name of the show he did?
Highway Patrol.
Highway Patrol. He was Mr. Knowledge. He knew everything that there was to. Do you remember him?
I remember watching the show.
Okay.
Sure.
And there was some kind of arrogance about him where somebody would say to him, "Well, do you think, sir?" He'd say, "No, that's not the way it is." And he would correct them, and he would always have more authority, more knowledge than anyone else in the police force. And it was that pomposity. I said, if the man believed he could fly, he would fly. And that actually, his that arrogance, that kind of superior knowledge, or confidence, that's a better word, that confidence he had was truly the inspiration for Chicken Man. Because remember, Chicken Man was convinced that he was more than just a guy dressed up in a chicken suit. He had all kinds of capacities and special abilities, none of which were true. He believed he could fly. I don't even remember where that came from. He could not fly. And some of the episodes, I don't think we'll be lucky enough to pull one from the material I brought here today, but one of the most famous ones was when he was on a bus and a little girl sitting beside him said, are you a chicken? And he said, yes, little girl, I am. Why are you a chicken? I fight crime and or evil. And she said, you fly? And I said, no, I don't fly. And can I have one of the feathers? I said, no, I don't give away the feathers. So she plinked one out, and you hear it in the series, bink. And she does that so many times, I keep asking her not to. Say, would you please stop doing that, little girl? The mother says, are you annoying my child? No, she wants my feathers, and I only have a limited number for this costume. I'm not sure I could give any away. So the bus, by this time, gets caught up in the story of what's going on with the little girl and the guy in the chicken suit, and they get involved in the argument. Any of you remember this? They get involved in the argument, and a demand is made that he jump. Oh, they're all going over a bridge at the moment that happens, and they insist that he get off the bus and jump off the bridge into the water, fly, and he can't. And so he stands on the railing of the bridge. It would be like, the bridge here. And they're screaming and yelling, and there's a big mob scene, and they finally have to call the masked marauder, the maternal marauder, whatever her name was. And she had to come and demand that he jump in the water. He can't fly, so he flaps his arms, which were also his wings, and then falls straight down into the water. And that was that episode. I get more references to that and remembrances of that than anything else.
We have not that one, but would you like to hear a little snippet of one of the Chicken Man episodes? All right, here it is, Dick Orkin as Chicken Man.
Now, another exciting episode in the life of the most fantastic crime fighter the world has ever known.
This is the Steel Pier in Atlantic City. Here, 16 times each day, a great horse leaps from a diving board into a huge tank of water. And describe the amazing horse as it dives as a man in a chicken suit.
Thank you, thank you.
And backstage, where the dressing rooms are located.
Pardon me, I'm the police commissioner of Midland City, and I'm looking for the wonderful winged warrior known as... Oh, next door. Thank you.
Come in.
Hello, winged warrior.
Commissioner Norton.
May I?
Of course.
I know you'll be diving again shortly, but a serious crime has been committed in Midland City, and I need your help, feathered fighter.
Commissioner, I'm no longer in the crime-fighting game, you know.
Yes, but the victim of this crime...
Showbiz is my life now.
...is someone you know.
Would you hand me my beak plugs?
Hmm?
Keeps the water from going up my beak.
He's an old friend of yours.
The horse doesn't need them, of course.
It's the mayor.
Oh, no, it's a real horse. See, the only fake part of the act is me in the chicken suit.
30 seconds, chicken!
Winged warrior, please listen.
We'll make it fast, Commissioner.
Right!
Mayor Weekly has been the victim of a foul... wicked crime.
Gee, that's too bad. Well, nice seeing you, Commissioner.
He slipped and fell on a banana peel.
Did you say banana peel?
Not just banana peels, candy wrappers, popsicle sticks, empty paper cups, tin cans. Midland City is being buried alive by...
The word, Commissioner, is pollution.
You're on, Wing Warrior.
Oh, former fighting fowl. I know that show business is your life now, but the life of a great city is at stake.
Commissioner.
Yes?
Long ago, I took a vow upon the golden chicken claw that I would not rest until all crime was crushed with one blow from my mighty fist.
Then you mean you'll give up?
I've come to say so long, partner. I've got a job to do back in Midland City. Oh, sure, I'll leave them for you. So long. Funny, never thought he got water up his nose.
Well, so the famous fowl is breaking up a famous showbiz duo just to break up an infamous scene of crime in Midland City. And another thing, doesn't that horse have a swell vocabulary?
Be listening tomorrow for another exciting episode in the life of the most fantastic crime fighter the world has ever known.
Any of you remember? Thank you. The voice at the very end there is the voice of, does anyone know? Jim Runyon, yes. Jim was the constant. He ad-libbed the last piece. When he did the well, from that moment on, that was all ad-libbed. I couldn't write that. I had no idea what he was going to do. And sometimes he broke us up so badly, Jane, who later became his wife, broke us up so badly that we had to stop recording and recover and then go on with it. Now, you heard some of the voices in there. You heard the man backstage where the diving horse was about to dive, and also he got the signal for 5 minutes till he goes on. The man who did that was one of Chicago's most, probably the wealthiest. No, I won't say that. He was the man who did more commercials and for television and radio. Was voiceover for television. And you probably didn't even recognize you. If you saw the man, you would say he did all of that. His name is Joel Corey, and he's sitting right here. Stand up, Joel. And sitting beside him was these. Both of them appeared in the Chicken Man series in various small roles because Jim Runyon and Jane and I couldn't do everything. So I had to bring some other people in, and Joel was one of them, and he did some things, Chicken Man. And then there was Beautiful Rita. Does anyone here know who Beautiful Rita was? Chicken Man's girlfriend. And Beautiful Rita was often called upon by Chicken Man at Penny Lane, and she's here too. Tooth Fairy, I'm sorry. These are two of probably the most active and the most concealed voices of all kinds of commercials and shows. Because I also know that you did other shows, and Penny's late husband, Wayne, was also involved in a lot of those voices as well. But with these two people and maybe one or two others, we managed to produce all of the various Chicken Man, Tooth Fairy, and I don't remember, many people, whatever else we did here. You had to be there. Yeah, absolutely right. Go ahead.
Why don't we go from WCFL and radio to advertising?
All right.
Before we do that, Dick, just listening to Chicken Man, what were they, about 5 minutes, something like that?
They were supposed to be 2.5 to 3 minutes, but they usually wound up about 4 minutes.
I mean, I think the most amazing thing listening to that is thinking this is in the middle of a top 40 rock and roll radio station format.
That's exactly right.
And that will never happen again.
No. It won't.
The fact that it happened once is pretty incredible.
Yeah. But what's odd about that, Bob, is that Ken Draper decided that he would go ahead and do that. I came up with the idea of Chicken Man only because he said he wanted to do a parody of Batman. I was doing a parody of a parody. And Ken Draper said, then he wanted me to do the Tooth Fairy. And I said to him, does this seem to be the right format? My doing this seemed to be right for the station. I was supposed to be the production director, and there was something about his choice of Chicken Man and Tooth Fairy for this music format, heavily formatted music station. Were you at WLSN?
No, not yet, but I was listening to LS and CFL, and I went to LS in 73, but I was an avid listener at that time.
Okay, but was Chicken Man ever or Tooth Fairy ever?
Tooth Fairy was at WLS.
Was at WLS?
Yes.
Okay. See, it's good to know these things. I had no idea.
I was at BBM FM in 71, and you had. So let's go back to you leaving Chicago, leaving radio, and eventually starting your business, which started here, didn't it?
Yeah, it did start here. I was asked to leave. I wasn't asked to leave. I decided. Sounds more dramatic, doesn't it? It was suggested gently that I leave. WCFL radio, and then it's only because a company. Do you know what a rep firm is? I don't suppose many of you do. Blair Radio is a rep firm. They came in and decided they had a music format that would be preferable to the one that was currently on WCFL, so they changed everything, and that included what I was doing, Chicken Man and Tooth Fairy. I had no reason to be at the station any longer. So I left there, opened my own business with a man by the name of Barry Stone, but he was better known as B. Ziggy Stone. And B. Ziggy Stone and I opened a company with two other fellows, I won't go into all the details, called the Creative Monopoly. I think it was on Erie. And was that right? Were we on Erie Boulevard? Was it Erie? And we decided we were just going to do commercials because I couldn't imagine that we could do anything more with radio serials. So we started the business of doing those commercials. But I did not want to do, and neither did B. Ziggy Stone, I just didn't want to do straight commercials because it seemed to me that the straight commercials that I was hearing on radio and not necessarily pointing the finger at you or anyone you were working with at the time, there was an awful lot of dull advertising going on. And in fact, I'm not so sure it still isn't going on. And that means that somebody decided they were going to write a piece of copy and just put all the facts about the product or the service. And I couldn't imagine doing that. It seemed to me that if you wanted to attract listeners, there had to be something more than simply straight facts. And everyone believed this, that happened. This is, I don't have my sheet. And is this, what does that say?
I don't have page one. It's gone, so.
Okay, I think I know which
one
it is.
You're on your
own. I think this is the one where, let me see if I can find it here. Oh, here it is. I'm gonna read a spot. Typical of the kind of commercials you might have heard in 65 to 70 or 73.
I think to 2015, probably. Yeah,
you're right, unfortunately. And it goes something like this. Excuse me. Everything's going, the eyes, the legs. Sit and Sleep is the largest mattress store in the USA. Sit and Sleep has been in business for 30 years. Customers all across Southern California have discovered a new way to shop for a mattress. They shop by phone at 1-800-675-3536. Over 2,000 quality Simmons, Serta, Spring Air, Miralux, Stearns & Foster, and Sealy mattresses are in stock and ready for immediate delivery. Purchase any premium mattress and you get a free 4-hour local white glove delivery, setup, and old mattress removal. You'll receive a free bed frame, free mattress pad, and 2 free pillows. As always, your comfort is guaranteed with their 30-night sleep trial. 30-night it says here. 30-day sleep trial. If you need a mattress and you need sit and sleep, shop by phone. It's as easy as 123. Call 1-800-675-3536. That's 1-800-675-3536. That's 1-800-675-3536. Honest to God, they wanted to put one more in there, and I wouldn't do it. Or visit Sit and Sleep in Culver City at Overland between Venice and Washington. Sit and Sleep is your 60,000-square-foot superstore. Now, the advertiser and the radio station was convinced that that piece of copy was all the people listening to the radio would have to hear in order for them to go and buy this Sit and Sleep mattress on sale. We had to do this spot for Sit and Sleep, and I thought, how can I do that in a funny way, or a humorous way, or an interesting way? I don't want to tell the whole story because it's unnecessary and it's complicated. But I came across, while I was visiting London, and I came across a book by the name of by an author called Ira Progoff. Any Ira Progoff fans here? Ira Progoff, no. Ira Progoff came up with a technique borrowed from Carl Gustav Jung called dialogue with experience, or alchemy. Do you remember what alchemy did? It took ordinary base metal and turned it into gold. Jung decided that that was never going to happen, it never did happen, that was really a metaphor for enlightenment. In other words, you take all those things in your life that you most hate, that you despise, that you'd like to forget, make use of them by internalizing them and do something with them, create something extraordinary with them. What he had in mind, I have no idea. I'm sure it wasn't a commercial. But I decided that I could use that technique to do a commercial. So what I needed to do, as the people who did alchemy would do, is I asked people in our office to come up with the worst experience they had in that particular subject. Now we're talking about, mattress. So I said, Sit and Sleep. So I said, I need to come up with something for Sit and Sleep. And did anyone have an experience buying a mattress that turned out to be a mistake and they just as soon forget it? Did they go into a store? Did they buy the mattress have a problem at home? Any number of things could happen. Is anyone here willing to tell us about some terrible experience they had with buying a mattress? I'm going to show you the technique we used to finally come up with this. Yes, this is the water cooler. Okay. So, anyone have an experience they want to tell me about?
Right here.
Is this a real experience you had?
Yes.
Are you kidding? This really happened to you?
This really happened. Sherwood Village in Des Plaines.
Oh, my God. Anyone else have a story? I don't object to that story. It's very good. But anyone else have an experience with buying a mattress, sleeping on a mattress, finding a mattress? Anyone?
Yeah, well.
Now you're trying to get the mattress down the stairs. It's like, it won't go.
Right.
It's stuck. We eventually had to chop the mattress into pieces so that we could get the old one out so the new one can come back.
Where did this happen?
My house.
In your house.
Chicago.
Where was your wife?
Laughing.
Did you know he was going to chop up the mattress to do this?
It was the old mattress.
What? Oh, it was the old mattress you had to chop up.
Right, in order to get it out.
Get it out. How did you get the new one in?
You know, we bent it.
You bent the new mattress
yeah.
to get it in. So you had a bent mattress going up the steps.
Right.
Okay. You were going to say, now, how in the hell is he going to do anything with this? Here's what we did. We selected a person who had that experience. Let's take the man with the bent mattress and ask him to come up here for a moment.
Sorry.
Do you mind coming up here?
Sure.
Stand over that on that side right there. That's good. Yeah. All right. So here's the man who had the experience with the bad mattress. And we did this in our radio ranch conference room. We would bring someone in and tell these stories. We'd ask for stories of anyone in the radio ranch or in the conference room. And we try to get some stories out of them. How did we get the stories out of them? By using what was called the alchemy or dialogue with experience. You talk to the person about their problem, because what you want to do, as they did in alchemy, is distill a story down to its most emotional, hot boiling point. That's what's going to make an emotional comedy spot. This is true. This is how we actually did it. So, Joel, if you'd step up here for a moment. You own the apartment building, and there's a bent mattress in the hallway, and you go up to his, or you take the back door and you go into his apartment, and you have a conversation with him about why there's a bent mattress coming down into your, or going up to your apartment.
I think we have a little problem. I don't know what to think of this. I don't know. You've been a good tenant. You pay your rent. I don't have a problem with that. You've never given me trouble before. But there's something going on in the stairwell. And no one can get in or out. And I'm sorry, I'm a little upset about it. There, it seems that this mattress belongs to you. It is jammed into the stairwell. Can you explain that to me?
We thought that all we needed to do was get it back down the stairs. That's the old mattress.
Wait a minute. Did you measure? Did you take some measurement? Did you go take a tape measure, or possibly even go out and spread your arms in the word stairwell? Certainly, it's not that difficult.
Well, it was close enough because we got it up here before. What I forgot is that the stairwell has been rebuilt.
Sweetheart, you look under stress. What's the matter, honey?
Don't try to help him, because I don't think helping him is...
Are you giving him a hard time?
Is this two against one now?
No. He's paranoid. No. I was just wondering. It's my husband.
Yeah.
And he looks a little stressed. And I'm wondering...
Well, I'm a little stressed.
Why?
I'm a little stressed. My tenants cannot get in and out of the apartment building. What is your problem with this thing? How did you do something that stupid?
Don't you dare call him stupid.
Why, do you reserve that for yourself? I don't get it.
Hysterical. Listen, little man.
Oh, now we're going to get personal. Is that the idea? You're going to get personal with me?
My husband is not stupid. These are things that happen in life. Okay.
Not to me. This is not necessary. First of all, I've got tenants climbing on me saying, I've got my groceries out there, my child is out there on the tricycle, and you, sir, have totally blocked the stairwell. I can't get anyone in or out of here. What are you going to do about it?
Why don't they sleep there? Go ahead.
You're not helping him.
Well, we were using the back stairs to bring up the tools that we could use to take the mattress apart to get it out of the stairwell. So, right.
You know, it's a wonderful explanation, but it's not working. Jack, it's not working. That is your name, Jack.
Excuse me, folks. The department sent me down here to see what the fuss was, and we could hear the noise from the street, and I'm going to ask you to decide what you want to do with your life. You're going to sit here and argue all day, or stand here and argue, or are you going to do something with your life? We can't take this.
Well, I'm sorry, but this is just not working out for me. What department was that, by the way?
I'll get back to you.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
All right, thank you. How about a round of applause for the Museum of Broadcast Communication Little Theater Players?
Okay, so you heard the drama. That's a story. We created a story there, just as we might do in our conference room at the Radio Ranch. We do it today in Los Angeles. We did it here at WCFL Radio. And the question that we always had to ask was the one I'm about to ask you now. How could you demonstrate what the mattress company is offering to the public by using the story, by using any elements of the story that you just heard? Anyone raise their hand and make it, yes, go ahead. Come out ahead of time and measure the, okay, this. This, is that a legitimate thing they're going to do, or a, you can have a, you can, it can, okay, so that's legitimate. It can be a funny thing that they do. It doesn't, just what elements from the piece I just did could be used to tell the story of the mattress company, Sit and Sleep Mattress. Yes, go ahead. Okay, it doesn't fit, we'll take it back. There it is. There's one of them you can use immediately. Go ahead.
If it doesn't fit, we'll buy you a bigger house.
Okay. Okay. Yes, go ahead. Anyone else?
Have a select comfort mattress that you can deflate and get around the corner.
Okay. Actually, it's not a bad idea for a mattress. All right. One more? Anybody have? Yes? Free Vaseline to grease the mattress. Yes, we probably would have used that. Okay. Well, that's it. That's how we developed, and that's why we call it dialogue with experience. It's a personal experience that is turned into a story. And how do we turn it into a story? By taking the people in the conference room, in this case it was Joel, who's representing someone in our conference room, and Penny, and we're developing a story. The whole point of creating a radio commercial that reaches out, grabs the audience, and says, oh, this should be interesting, is a story. If you can't develop a story, please don't do the straight spot that I read to you, that you heard in the beginning. But what I'm about to say, I don't believe, and don't take it the wrong way. But it was... It was at, I'm trying to think of the name of it, Y&R, Young and Rubicam. And someone at Young and Rubicam said, remember this, that your people who listen to commercials have some sanity about themselves. You just can't say anything you want to them. In other words, you can't give them all the facts and expect that they're going to sit there, put everything aside and say, oh, I must listen to this. Oh, this is so exciting. I just, for example, let me give you, here's what the announcer thinks is going to happen. He thinks that, what is the commercial that you have that I gave you the, okay. All right. Okay. For example, imagine there's a water cooler in the office. What the people who create the commercial, the straight commercial, believe is going to happen is this. But this is, how many times would you, having heard that spot for Sit and Sleep, would you actually do this?
You know, I was...
Hi.
Hi, how are you? How you
good,
doing?
I'm doing good.
Yeah, you want two sugars?
Yeah, two sugars.
I'm sorry.
I'm going to get it later.
You know, I wanted to tell you something. I was listening to the radio last night, I was listening to the game, and this commercial came on, and it absolutely blew me away.
No kidding.
Yeah, no kidding. I don't know. I wonder if you were listening.
What was it?
It was for a mattress company that was.
I heard that.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Am I right? Did you get that?
Fantastic.
I know. Unbelievable.
Did you hear the way the announcer said 1-800-678?
You know what I loved about.
Oh my God.
What was that number again? 1-800.
654-3897-4-5-2,
right. But here's the best part. I love that they repeated it so many times so I could, you know, keep it in mind. I would, just amazing. I memorized it.
Exactly.
800.
Well, don't press me.
Yeah, I got it. But I think about it, I'll get it.
But
anyway.
What about the white glove delivery?
Oh, baby. And not only white glove, I mean, imagine, I assume that means that once they have delivered it, you as the customer are allowed to inspect the gloves to make sure that mattress was totally clean before it ever
I have always
your
wanted
house.
To do that.
Yeah, I mean,
I've always wanted to have a delivery glove. Man come to my house with white gloves and let me inspect them.
Hey, how about the 30-night guarantee? You can sleep
do you love
on it. Yeah, here's the great part. Think about this. You sleep on it for 29 nights. You call them up. They take the old mattress out of there. They replace it with another one. You got 29 more nights. Free, totally free. And again, if this one's no good, bam, you get another one right away.
This is very innovative. Fantastic. I don't think anybody's ever thought of that before.
I don't know. It's an amazing
idea.
And
I loved the list of all the different mattress companies.
Well, you know, that you've got to have that choice.
Yeah. But
you
know,
have you ever gone
a great commercial.
Mattress shopping? I take 3 days. Because I like to, well, I lay on one for, you know, 20, 30 minutes. Well, you've got Serta, now you've got Sealy, now you've got Perfect Sleeper, you've got all of these things you can't.
Fabulous.
How are you going to know?
Right, fabulous. Oh. And I love the idea of being able to phone in for
yes.
a mattress.
The phone is a great
device. Talk about being blown away.
Yeah.
Phone in to buy a mattress.
And this way you can make sure that, and you can even check the hours. How long is the place open? I mean, there's a good. This place is tremendous.
Listening to that commercial was time well spent.
I'll tell you. I really enjoyed it.
I took a long time, Bob, to answer that question, but that is how the Radio Ranch did commercials, both here at WCFL Radio, and still does commercials in Los Angeles. It's simply coming up with a story. And the only way you can come up with a story is to do the thing that we did a little bit earlier than that. But the reason they don't do stories is because advertisers and radio stations truly believe that people are going to gather around the water cooler or sit in the office the next morning and have the conversation. And only morons would sit and have a conversation about a mattress offer like that. And I remember it was, I tried to remember his name earlier, that is at YNR, Young and Rubicam, that it was Rubicam who said, remember, the consumer is not a moron. She is your wife. He didn't mean it the way you think he did. Okay. Okay, now, go ahead.
Dick, let me jump in here for a second. First of all, back to the example of the horrendous radio commercial you did. And by the way, I think I read that on GN the other day. Talk a little bit about how you convince someone to do that, because I can think of many clients at our radio station who are doing commercials like that. And then I imagine going to them and saying, look, this is ridiculous. Here's why. Instead of having somebody read this copy, invest a little bit, have somebody record this, rewrite it. You've given us your theories and analysis of how to convert that into a good radio spot. What's the way you get that done? You convince the client that this is the way to go.
We just did the spot. We took the position that we were going to write the spot they wanted. They gave us all the details, all of the uninteresting facts, terrible facts. And then they said, do that spot. So we did that spot, but we also did our own spot, the one that came out of the story making. And we played them both, and 9 chances out of 10, you know which spot they would take. Because they'd say, yeah, people would be far more interested in that. And that's the truth. I don't think we ever had anyone turn us down when we did the that spot. In some cases, they already knew that we did that kind of spot, so there wasn't an argument about do my spot, the straight spot, if you want to. And we just didn't argue about it, that's all. I remember one time a bank, very nervous about our doing comedy for a banking institution, prestigious and very serious, came to here in town, came to the office and said, our manager doesn't mind your doing humor but and comedy, but try and do serious comedy. And I remember Bert looking at me and my looking at Bert saying, yeah, sure, sure, that's what we're gonna do. Yeah.
And you mentioned the bank. Say a little bit about a commercial that we run on WGN. People here are familiar with.
I'll tell you, yeah.
For the bank.
They have been a wonderful client. And I can't even remember the number of years we've had them. I think that spot is queued to go. And if it is, you can just play the spot and then I'll talk about it.
Okay, here it is. Listen.
Dickie, Grandma, buy big beautiful house by Ellie.
Oh, yeah?
Make a B&B bed, breakfast, borscht, and bagels.
An investment.
Become real estate mogul.
I think you mean mogul.
Yeah.
Great. You can get your mortgage at First American Bank.
Grandma have different way.
Huh?
People says questions. Grandma tells what to do. People pays money.
Like a life coach.
No, like a bossy pants.
Why not go to First American for a mortgage?
Good question, Dickie. $1,000.
Are you serious?
More good question. Now you owes $2,000.
Grandma, please, First American makes getting a mortgage painless. When you call them, they always follow up with personal service.
That's good.
And if the property comes in below First American's estimate of value, you don't pay for the appraisal.
Well, okay, Grandma, go to First American, but you still owe us $2,000.
You are a bossy pants.
Thanks, you dickie.
First American Bank, the bank that does more for your money. Get started on your mortgage. Visit firstambank.com. Call 847-952-3700. Like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
When we decided to do that, thank you. You don't have to applaud. Not necessary for the applause. I got the applause a long time ago. That was Christine Coyle playing the grandmother. Chris is a resident of Chicago, and she came to work with us here in Chicago, and has continued. She has been my creative partner for, I guess, about 11 years. Out on the West Coast. She's no longer working with us. She's now working in television for another company. But every once in a while, there are some things we have to do together. That's one of them. That bank, First American Bank, still insists that Chris and I do those spots. So Chris has to take time off from working for the other people to come and do that that spot with me. We still do it. You know.
Yes. And you're do you ever feel, do you ever go to a client who says, you know, I'm very happy, keep doing this forever, and say, you know what, I think the listener may need something a little different, something else?
Never. To be honest with you, I've never had that experience. Once we start them on that, in fact, if we attempt to change it, as a car dealer one time asked us, requested we do, and we did, and for 2 months, we just did straight spots, fully confident that they weren't going to last very long, and we were right, because the dealer heard from the audience and from potential buyers who simply said, what happened to the spots that were funny? We don't want to listen to those spots anymore. So that can happen, yeah.
And I think you should talk a little bit about, we were talking earlier about Ron Britton, one of the great WCFL
yes.
DJs, and his theater of the mind approach. And that's been very much your approach, too, in addition
yes.
to what you talked about, the way you produce a radio spot. But you're creating visual images, aren't you?
Yes. That's it. They are images. They're pictures. Radio doesn't have the capacity to show you a picture, except the one that you hold in your mind. And the reason that I insist that we use relatives or your own experience is because there's something universal about them. Everyone says, I have an uncle like that. I have a father like that. I have a mother like that. And that helps sell the spot faster than anything else because they can say, that's believable. I know someone like that. They're but for the grace of God, go I. Yeah.
And were you influenced by Stan Freberg, who famously demonstrated what all you could do on radio?
Yes, no question about it. Stan, in the very beginning, it was Stan Freberg spots that had the most influence on me. Then it was Bob and Ray. Bob and Ray, I guess, is there something?
Then it was me, I believe, wasn't it?
Then it was you. Then it was you, yes. And yours was really, you really had some funny ones.
Yeah, thank you. And so bring us up to date now on what you're doing today. You continue to be producing radio commercials, getting these awards and getting in various halls of fame. Do you ever miss radio? It seems like ages ago that you were part of WCFL.
Well, I'm not going to give my age, but I mentioned in accepting the award that I'm in the afternoon of my life, or maybe early evening, and it's about 10:30 or 11 o'clock. So I retired from doing those kinds of commercials in a very simple manner. I turned the whole business over to my daughter, Lisa, who is very capable of doing this, and my son, Harris, and my brother, Sanford, all of whom are capable of doing the same thing. And I am supposed to be retired, but you can see how retired I am, because all I'm doing is going out and talking about what I did do. But it's still, I'm happy to be away from that for a while. It was a long trek.
Since we lost page one of the script, let me ask you, Dick, before we turn it over to you for some questions and before I ask any more questions, was there another spot in particular you wanted to talk about or something you needed to demonstrate?
Is there another spot on the audio people? Okay. Yes. Here's a spot that was done by my daughter, Lisa, for one of the most successful. In fact, I'm pretty sure Regional Help Wanted, they probably have another name, is here in Chicago. Does that name sound familiar? Regional Help Wanted? It would be ChicagoRegionalHelpWanted.com. It may not be. But here is the spot that my daughter Lisa produced. And this is right now one of the most popular spots in the whole. It plays everywhere in the country. So let's play that one if you have it.
You're not a dental hygienist?
No, Dr. Snarman, I don't know the first thing about it.
Why did you answer my want ad?
I was looking at the personals on that free internet site, whatchamacallit list, when I saw your want ad and thought, hey, that could be fun.
Free internet classified ad sites may be free, but do you really want your ad listed along with singles, used cars, and puppies?
But you didn't study to be a dental hygienist in school?
No, musical theater, so I can sing and dance and entertain all your patients.
I don't need my patients entertained.
If you need a qualified employee, you need RegionalHelpWanted.com.
Open your mouth, ignore the pain, you're gonna get some Novocaine.
I need a dental hygienist.
Teeth don't hide, mouth open wide.
With RegionalHelpWanted.com, you can peruse resumes of qualified employees 24/7 and avoid those people looking for puppies, used cars, and...
Turn on the drill. Wow, that's shrill. Here we go.
Phil. This is fun.
RegionalHelpWanted.com. Long name, amazing results.
Jill. There's one other thing that just occurred to me as I glanced at Joel. If you remember in the Tooth Fairy series, we had a dental organist. The guy didn't have any music coming in headsets, so we had to have a live dental organist in Tooth Fairy in the office where he did the dental work, in the treatment room. And that was Joel who played the organ. And saying that he would just improvise a song. I'd say, the patient would say to me, do you know that I have a pain all the way in the back of my mouth? And I'd say, sorry, I forgot the first name. Raul, do you know this man has a pain all the way in the back of his mouth?
He doesn't even come from the south, but I'll tell you something.
Yes.
And then Ziggy would play the organ.
Yeah, Ziggy would play the organ, and then you'd see him sing the song. But that's it.
Two questions. Sure. First, every year, Super Bowl time, people do the favorite commercials, and much is written about and talked about with those commercials, and many of them are very entertaining, but we find out are not effective. What about the entertainment value versus the what you're trying to do, which is sell a product? Is there ever a danger in getting carried away with a funny spot that does not sell?
I suppose there has been. I don't talk about them. But I'm pretty sure there has been. I'm not aware of them right now. I'm being honest. I don't remember anyone complaining about
them. But it's not something you consciously think about when you're doing
these. No, I don't. I can't think about it. There have been moments when a comedy spot we did simply didn't work for the. I mean, that can happen. It simply didn't work for the advertiser, so we had to come up with another one. It's not unusual for us to do 3-4 spots before the advertiser says, yeah, that one will work. And we do that all the time at the Radio Ranch.
And we should not let the afternoon go by without you doing a little bit of biography, answer the question, how you came to Chicago, why did you come here in the first place, and a little bit about your background. I know you were a theater guy, but also didn't you major in psychology as well?
Yes, I had... There were three historical educational backgrounds. One was I attended Franklin Marshall College for my AB back in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. And then I went on to, help me with this, Dee Dee, if you can remember some of them. Attended Yale Drama School. And then following that, for reasons I still am not clear about, I decided that I would go to Phillips Graduate Institute and earn my degree, a master's degree, in marriage and family therapy. Thank you.
Apparently you haven't taken the memory course yet, though, have you?
No. If they don't stay with me,
yeah, probably. I think one of the most famous radio commercials you did certainly garnered the most awards. We played it the other day when you were nice enough to be on our show on GN, was the spot for Time Magazine, and a very interesting backstory on that.
Yeah, there is. I don't know that we have that.
Yes, they have.
Oh, they do? Okay. Would you play that for them, please?
All right, here we go. Let's listen.
Hi.
Hi.
Gee, it's dark in here.
Yeah.
Yeah, one Time Magazine, please.
What?
Time Magazine. It's a magazine. It's called Time.
We ain't got it.
Yeah, but your sign out front says magazines.
All we got is special magazines.
Well, Time is special. I'm surprised you don't carry it.
All we got is special magazines and special movies.
Oh, well, Time has a fascinating cinema section.
Cinnamon?
No, cinema. That's movies. Movies, cinema, same thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm surprised you wouldn't carry a magazine as excellent as Time here.
What can I tell you?
See, Time provides fascinating insights into the people and events that illuminate our... Oh, see, that dark corner over there where that gentleman in the raincoat is standing?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, if you had Time Magazine, you'd have men standing around reading all over the place.
We don't have no Time Magazine.
Do you mind if I look?
$2.
For what?
For looking.
Are you kidding? $2 just to look at these magazines here?
That's right.
But these are... They'll change for a five.
Time Magazine, the most colorful coverage of the week.
Doing that spot in the very beginning, I did it. I said, let's do a gag spot and send it to Time Magazine. In other words, I don't intend it to go on the air. It's just, it's only intended to be a gag spot. So I sent it to Y&R, And YNR made the mistake of sending it to Time Magazine. And Time Magazine put it on the air. And Ralph Lennon, who was the publisher of the magazine, called us and said, "Why did you put a spot like that on the air?" And I said, "Well, Mr. Lennon, who's the publisher, asked us to put it on the air." And they said, "I don't think so." I said, "Yes, he really did." Later, it was on the air, and I later learned that, in fact, Ralph Lennon did go to YNR and say, "I like that spot. I run the magazine. I'll tell you what goes on the air." And that's exactly what happened, yeah.
And just to fill in before we take questions, how you got to Chicago and the job at WCFL that led to Chicken Man and many other things for you.
I was in college at Franklin Marshall College, and it was summer vacation time. I didn't have any reason for going all the way back home again. So they offered me a job on WLAN in Lancaster, and WLAN in Lancaster, and that's how I started the job there. I actually was not I wasn't a DJ in this full sense of DJ, reading a hard straight copy. I didn't do any of that. They wanted me to read straight copy when I was there, and it was only when I was able to break away from all of that and go find some other people to work for, like Ken Draper in Cleveland, and then Ken Draper again here in Chicago, that I was able to break away from all of that.
So Ken Draper brought you and many others from Cleveland to Chicago.
No question, yes, he did. And many of them, yes. I can't tell you how many DJs through the years, including the years that you were working at WLS, was the result of Ken Draper inviting people to come to Chicago and work for various radio stations. I mean, how did you get the job on WLS?
A clerical error, some...
No, I don't believe that.
I was in FM here at WBBM-FM.
Right, you were at WBBM.
And they decided to raid the station because FM at the time was having a little too much success, and WLS was concerned about that.
Yeah.
But Ken Draper, he brought Larry Lujack to Chicago.
Brought Larry Lujack, yes.
And many of the people he brought in later worked at both stations. But I think the talent was unbelievable. Jerry G. Bishop, Jim Runyon, Jim Stagg,
Barney
Britton,
Pip.
Barney Pipp. All brought in by Ken Draper.
All names from Chicago. A few of them were from Cleveland, but most of them were from Chicago. I can't tell you to what extent Chicago became the breeding ground for radio talent that later spread all across the United States. And you told me that Ron Britton, for example, who was very popular on WCFL radio, is where now?
He lives in Louisville.
He lives in Louisville.
Right.
And I wouldn't be surprised if he's on the air there as well. Okay.
So are we done with the prepared material now?
Does anyone have... Yes, we are, Bob. Does anyone have... I can't take too many because we're getting close to our time. But does anyone have any questions they'd like to ask? All the way in the back, last man back there.
Yeah. Well, it may be a good idea to come up to the microphone here. Sure.
I don't know if you remember this, but you did an ad for the Tribune where you were going out to get the Tribune in the morning and you put on your wife's robe.
It was Time Magazine.
Oh, was it Time?
It was Time Magazine spot. The policeman saw him walking around in his wife's house coat and picked him up and said, we don't want people in this neighborhood doing that kind of thing. And they took him to the, and he said in the car to the policeman, please don't send me up the river for reading Time Magazine. That was the puffy sleeve spot. You're right, that's correct.
Thank you, sir.
Anyone else? Yes.
Come on right up to the microphone.
I've come from Benton Harbor, Michigan today. And I would like like to know why Chicken Man's real name was Beth Harmon.
You can sit down, Elfie. Thank you. Yes, in the WCFL newsroom, there was a huge map of the United States. I needed a name for my hero. I wanted it to sound like it was a staid a name, something you wouldn't expect. There were any number of possibilities I could have come up with, but I just happened to see Benton Harbor as I scanned the map. I said, that's a good name, Benton Harbor. That sounds like a real, the straight name, the alias name of a superhero. So that's how that's honest to God the truth. That's how I used it, yeah. Anyone else? Yes.
I had a hard time figuring out who of the two were my favorite characters. So who was it more fun to be and play, the commissioner or Chicken Man?
I do have an answer for that. I think I had more fun playing the commissioner because he was a man who just simply couldn't settle himself into the position of commissioner. You remember his favorite pastime when he wasn't doing anything else in his office? I don't think he did very much at all in the office. But do you remember what he did? Yeah, he had a coloring book. And all he did was call Miss Helfinger, who is the secretary, and say, Miss Helfinger, I have a question for you. If you combined yellow and pink, what color would you get? And she'd say, what are you coloring? Why do you need to know this? And he'd say, I'm coloring a sunset. And she said, that would be all right, you can do that. Thank you very much. Wait, don't go, I have one more question. If I wanted to combine the colors of black and blue, what would I get? Nothing. Thank you very much. And that's true. Anybody else?
This is very thorough. I actually don't have questions, but I definitely wanted you to know that I had gratification of working with an engineer in Chicago named Sheldon Post.
Oh, yes. Shelley was responsible for doing much of the Tooth Fairy, and some of the Chicken Man, but mostly Tooth Fairy. And he was, and this was where?
Basically, we worked at WCFL in the last year.
Yes, yeah. WCFL. Very talented. Where is Shelley, by the way?
Last time, actually, unfortunately, in the world of business here, is, you know, at CFL, I think it was in 82, they had 15 engineers, and 84.
Wow.
And he left and opened up some stores, some retail stores.
Oh. Okay.
I'm not sure, but he basically, when we worked together.
If you should ever run into him again, tell him I send my regards. He was a talented engineer.
It was a great time for me to work with him.
Yeah.
And it was great to hear the stories and the gratification he had working with you.
Yeah.
Also, one other thing, Region Hub Wanted is an interesting story, and that's owned by a man named Eric Strauss. And I know Eric.
Yes. Yes.
Really enjoys the work of the Video Ranch.
I know.
His father was basically the general manager of WMCA.
Yes.
During their formative years, also worked in the Johnson.
That's correct. Yes.
What's your name, sir?
My name is Mike.
Mike. Okay, and Afternoon with Mike will be here at the next week. You'll hear more of those stories at that time. Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Bob. There's good suggestion.
There's a couple.
That was a good suggestion, coming up. Bob. Oh, yes.
Amazon Ace. Oh my God.
Here's my problem. I did do Amazon Ace, but I can't find it. That's the truth. Do you have it?
I'm looking around for it as well. I've got the Chicken Man and the Tooth Fairy.
If you ever hear of anyone who has a copy of Amazon Ace, we will pay money honest to God, I just don't know what happened to it. Amazon Ace. It was Amazon Ace was originally a series called Congo Kurt, and it came out of Cleveland where I worked with two performers there. But that is the story. Okay, you're welcome. Someone else? Yeah.
Hi,
Mr. Dick.
Hi.
How are you?
You look familiar.
Okay. So, we worked together from 73 to 78, but I had brown hair.
Who are you?
Holly.
It's Holly.
Oh, my God.
So, here's a question I've wondered about.
I'm embarrassed. I can't tell you. Holly Birnbaum was the den mother to the stars at WCFL Radio.
No, at Dick and Bird.
At Dick and Bird. At Dick and Bird Creative Services. Well, it's been a while since I've seen you. Yes. But so go ahead, Holly.
You often put words to music, and one that I remember was the jingle for, I think it had to do with drink your milk today for health enjoyment, keep a cow off unemployment.
Yes.
And so I'm not a singer. So.
That was it.
I just wondered if you could talk a little bit about the process of putting words to music.
Well, I had help with that, and one of the, you may have been among the people who helped with that, Holly, when we were at WCFL Radio, or at, was it CFL?
No, it was at
Okay, you may have helped with that. The other person, Joel, may have helped with that. Certainly Christine Coyle helped with it. Christine was especially gifted in doing that kind of thing. I was absolutely not gifted in doing that. I couldn't do that. A lot of people did. Anyone else? If not, oh, is there one more? Yeah.
This is not really a question, it's a comment. In the Navy in 1977, I served with Far East Network with American Forces and Radio and TV. So Chicken Man was not only in the United States, it was around the world with the military. I had the morning shift from 6 to 9 in Japan. If I missed Chicken Man, the telephone would just ring and ring saying, where is Chicken Man? So, you know, accolades to you, but
tell me,
the military around the world.
Tell me your name.
Carl Henderson.
Okay, and where were you assigned? Where were you?
Far East Network, Marine Corps Air Station, Iwakuni, Japan. 73 to 77.
Somewhere around the late 60s, we decided to give Chicken Man to Armed Forces Radio, and then we gave it to AFVN. So I'm not surprised to hear that, and I'll tell you one of the most satisfying stories that ever happened to me. I would do workshops all across the country during the last 30 years, and I would have people like you come up and tell me about their experience with Chicken Man. And many of them said things to me that touched me so deeply that I couldn't forget it, and that was, my sanity in the service was saved by Chicken Man.
So true. Again, thank you.
You're very welcome.
I think we can squeeze in one more. Was there somebody else who wanted to come up here? A young man, why don't you come up here? This is a young man I think I grew up listening to when I was a kid.
We can hear you, that's all right.
How long did it take to make one episode?
Good question.
Good question, very good question. Well, it took me about an hour and 20 minutes to write the episode, maybe an hour and a half to write the episode. Then it took about an hour and a half to actually record the episode. That took care of the whole morning. The afternoon was spent with engineers like Shelley Post or Mike King actually editing, putting the music behind it, putting the sound effects behind it, and if we had any other performers introduced to it, we would put them in at that time. But that's a good question. It was a whole day. Doing one Chicken Man took a whole day. Thank you. Good question.
We're going to have to let Dick go now, but let me just say a couple of things in closing. First of all, I remember it was a great thrill for me as a kid working at WMAQ Radio off the air in doing some writing back in the late 60s to work with Dick a little bit when you had your place on Oak Street.
Yes.
We did something, some fun house or something, yes. I don't know what it was. But I still remember going to some teen club in the 60s and being thrilled because I don't remember what the band, who the band was, but Chicken Man made an appearance, and it was one of, I don't think you got a lot of money for this appearance, Dick, because you didn't fly in, you just walked into the room in your chicken suit. But the popularity of that feature and the impact, we used to talk a lot about impact with my colleagues at WLS back in the 70s, but 50 years later, to have this kind of impact is really something special.
That's, it is Chicken Man's 50th anniversary, as a matter of fact.
Is that right? Year, yeah. But, you know, we in Chicago, I think, got a great kick out of your great success with the national radio commercials, but we always had a special affinity for you here because of your work on Chicken Man and other production on a great radio station, WCFL. And thanks to all of you for coming today. And Dick Orkin, we really, really enjoyed this afternoon.
Yes, thank you Thank you all. Thanks. Thank you.
Let me know what city we're working next together.
You did a great job.
Thank you. You made it very easy.
Thank you all very much.